So good morning, everybody, and welcome to Real Life Church. I'm Pastor Bob, and I'm leading this morning. Before we get going into our message, hey, there's that QR code right there. You can see it. Why don't you take a picture of it? Because that's going to take you right to our website where you can find out what's happening at Real Life Church. One of the biggest things that's coming up for us is Easter Sunday morning. We're asking our community to join us here on our campus during one of our three services that we have scheduled, 9, 10:30, and in Spanish at 12. Now, in our in-person services, we've been filling out Easter eggs. That's representing people that we're inviting to join us on that Sunday morning. Do you know how you can do that? You could share this video right now with your friends. You can do that on whatever platform that you're using. Share it with your friends. I believe what we're talking about this morning is crucial. It's a tough topic, and I think everybody needs to hear it. So, let's get into it. To date, we have had 7 messages in the book of James, and we just finished chapter 1. We're going to begin chapter 2 this morning. Now, one of the characteristics of God, and by the way, God has lots of characteristics. We call them attributes, and there are so many of them. Like, God is holy, he's all-powerful, he's everywhere present. I mean, he knows everything. We know that God doesn't change. We know that he's sovereign, that he loves us, that he shows us grace, he shows us mercy, and those are just a few of his attributes. But there is one more attribute that we don't talk about a lot. It's the attribute of God being impartial. That means that God, when he deals with people, he's not a respecter of persons. He's impartial towards everyone. He's that way. Unfortunately, we're not. We have the tendency to stratify people. We put some people in higher categories, and we put some people in lower categories. Sometimes it has to do with looks. Sometimes it has to do with wardrobe. Sometimes it has to do with the car that they drive or the house they live in. Sometimes it even has to do with race or social status. Sometimes we just put people into categories based on what they look like. I'm going to tell you something. With God, every one of those things that we just mentioned are non-issues. They mean absolutely nothing to him. A person's education, their economic status, the way they look, their social relationships, the job that they have, their fame, their prestige, all of those mean absolutely nothing to God. They are what we would say non-issues. Now, several places in the scripture, beginning in the Old Testament and basically all the way through the New Testament, we're reminded that God is not a respecter of people. In Deuteronomy chapter 10, for example, Moses, the writer of that, says that God is the God of gods. He is the Lord of lords. He's a great and mighty and awesome God. And then he throws this in, that does not show partiality. In other words, God doesn't count it against a person or for a person by who he is. In the New Testament, Peter reminds us of that same principle, that the gospel is open to everyone, whether you're Jew or whether you're Gentile, and that God, again, doesn't draw a distinction between the two different types of people. Now, unfortunately, we have a difficult issue with this because we're very partial. And it is a difficult topic because it really kind of hits close to home to where we are as a country, maybe even as a world. And so we need to discuss it because it's in the scripture today. If you remember some of the Bible stories, Nathanael doubted that any good thing could come out of Nazareth. Do you remember that? Do you remember making that statement? I find it hard to believe that any good thing can come out of Nazareth. And then there was a Samaritan woman who hesitated to give a drink of water to Jesus because he was a Jew. See, there's all kinds of these examples in the Bible of prejudice and racism and favoritism. And I'm going to tell you, every time, God says the same thing. Don't. Because it doesn't reflect his character. It says, my brethren, do not hold your faith in the glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism. For if a man comes into your assembly with a gold ring and dressed in fine clothes, and there also comes in a poor man in dirty clothes, and you pay special attention to the one who's wearing the fine clothes and say, you sit here in a good place. And you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down by my footstool. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judge with evil motives? Listen, my beloved brethren, did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Is it not rich who oppress you and personally drag you into court? Do they not blaspheme the fair name by which you have been called? James is trying to address a really prevalent issue that was back then and continues to be prevalent today. Because of our humanness, because we are sinners, we're not God, and we have a tendency not to be able to look at people impartially. And even though it's a non-issue with God, it's a huge issue with us. Like we said when we kicked off this book, right? That James is straight shooting, okay? It's a series of tests. Look, we've looked at the test of what? Trials. We've looked at the test of temptation. We've looked at the test of how we ought to respond to God's word. And here's a new test this morning. The test of partiality. The test of favoritism. How do we respond to people? How do we respond, like the passage says this morning, to the people that are poor or needy? Or how do we respond to the people who are rich and have a lot? And how do we treat them? And do we treat them any different? So in this passage, we're reminding ourselves, okay, that everyone should be treated equally. And there's nothing wrong with treating the rich man and giving him the best seat in the house as long as you're willing to give the poor man the best seat in the house. But when we cater to one group of people over another group of people, well, we're in trouble. And James gives us the illustration. And did you see it? The fingers of gold? Okay, now, back then, you know, that's how they represented wealth. If you had a lot of rings, and can I just say this? Maybe we tend to forget this because we forget a lot of the early church history. The church was poor, okay? The people that comprised the church during that time were the needy, the poor. They were not the rich people. Now, there may have been rich people in the building, if you want to call it, but the great majority of what was coming to know who Jesus was back then were the poor and the needy. Now, we don't want to miss this also because, you know, James gave us the illustration. It isn't the needy, the ones that are coming to know Christ. And it really does make sense, right? Because you need to understand that we're all needing a Savior, right? That none of us can get to heaven based on our own merit. And so James is kind of reminding us that we were all once poor spiritually. I like to say the word spiritually bankrupt. That's when you decide that you can go no farther on your own and you need a Savior. That's where everybody starts. Back kind of to our illustration of this brother who comes in and the church treats him special because he has a lot of money. Why? It's a great question. And it's a great question for us today. Why would a church want to pay more attention to someone who's more affluent? Maybe you're expecting something from him. Maybe you're expecting some help from him. You know what I mean? To be able to get some extra from him because he has a lot to give, right? And let's not pay too much attention to the poor or the needy because, you know, they're not going to be able to give much or do much because they're what? Well, they're needy. And that type of behavior, can I just say this, is anti-Christian behavior. It's a sin. We need to call it what it is. When we're showing favoritism or partiality or when we're being racist in any kind of form, we're sinning because we're not acting the way God does when God acts towards us impartially. So how do we put this into practice? This is a tough one, okay? This is a huge issue, and I'm keeping it short this morning because a lot has already been said in this area, but the practical application of this passage is so important. First of all, will you follow the world's standard and the way the world does things, or do you follow God's standard? That's a great question. I mean, if we're saying that God is not a respecter of persons, we want to be careful because we ought to respect everyone. But what we ought to say is we're not going to respect anybody's status, what they have or what they don't have. And we're going to choose to treat everybody equally. Our world shows favoritism in so many different ways. And it really has come to light as of recent. Please, please remember, when we show favoritism, that does not honor God. Second thing I was thinking about is we ought to love people like God loves people. For God so loved the world, okay? He loves boys and girls. He loves men and women. He loves young and old. He loves rich and poor. He loves everyone, okay? And so should we, because that's exactly what Jesus said that we ought to do. We should love God and we should love other people. We should not draw lines in the sand and say, if you do this, then I'll love you more. And if you can't do that, then I won't love you. See, that doesn't work. See, the church, okay, the church, you and I as the church, ought to be the place and the people where everyone is welcome to the gospel and welcome to God's love, regardless of their status. We should not overlook anyone, and we should not over appreciate any person, especially for our personal gain. If God doesn't show favoritism, nor should we. And that's what I got this week. All right? Tough message, but exactly, again, the message we need to hear comes up in the passage, right? We got to talk about it. And more importantly, we got to go back and do what we talked about last week. We just can't hear it. We got to go out and we have to live it. All right? Let me pray for you. God, thanks for our time together. Thank you for your word, even the hard parts. God, these are difficult passages and this is a tough one. This is one of them that maybe we would have been best skipping, but then again, we wouldn't be true to your word. You put it in there so that James could communicate that to the churches that were scattered. And God, it's in there today for us to be able to see it and God, avoid it at all costs. God, forgive me where I have showed favoritism. Forgive me where I have treated different people based on their status differently than I would someone else. God, help us and remind us and help us to love people and see people like you do. And it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, share that video, okay? We've got a way for you to be able to do that. Share it with your friends, all right, in Jesus' name. And I'll see you guys back next week.
Some tests last 2 weeks. This test lasted 2 decades. A study in the book of James. Join us for the sermon series, The Test.